Well, from the outside looking in, our next guest appeared to have the ideal life. She's one of Australia's most successful publicists, managing celebrities and some of the world's biggest brands. She's a mother and has a wide circle of friends. But little did anyone know, behind closed doors, Tori Archibald was in deep trouble. For more than a decade, she was being stalked and harassed by her ex-partner. Tori's story is not an isolated one. On average, one in four Australian women will experience abuse by a current or former partner. And for today's agenda, I'm pleased to say publicist Tori Archibald joins me now, along with Karen Willis from Domestic Violence Services Australia. Good morning and welcome to you both.
Thank you.
Tori, it's brave, it's very courageous to speak about this, and we salute you for doing so, and thank you. You're going to... there's an article in Marie Claire which comes out today. Just take us back to the beginning. How did this all begin? Give us more of an understanding of what you've experienced.
So what I thought was a loving relationship didn't turn out to be quite that way. And we had a child together when my daughter was 9 months old. In 2005, I made the decision that I was in a relationship which wasn't aligned with my values. It was very much based on lies and manipulation, and I thought, I have the opportunity now to either step away from this and mark out a future that aligns with my values and the values that I wanted for our child, or I could stay, which many people do, and put up with the situation. So I made the brave decision a week before Fashion Week to actually move out of the family home. My daughter was 9 months old and no one knew anything. I did 12 Fashion Week parades that year, and it was a very toxic environment, very highly stressful result of what actually happened when I made that brave move.
Well, he resented you making that move and went on to, as I understand it, stalk you and harass you for 10 years.
12 years,
12
actually.
Years.
Yeah, so it only really completed the cycle in 2017. So he didn't like the fact that I stood up and held him accountable, and I wanted the truth to be known. And off the back of that, I was getting up to 100 text messages, phone calls to my office, emails every day, and I was lucky that I was granted an AVO, which put some boundaries around the situation. But then the situation of taking me back to court relentlessly every year started, and I went to court up to 8 times a year. So on top of being a single mum, running a business, having global clients, I was also very familiar with the court process, which was a very scary process to start off with.
I don't doubt it. Karen, Tori's story, as we say, is not an isolated one. Many, many women endure this suffering and they keep it under wraps. Why is that? Is it a sense of shame? They don't want to share it?
Certainly shame is one of the many impacts of trauma. Fear of what the offender might do. And often a feeling of self-blame, because that will be part of the manipulative process that goes on in a domestic violence relationship, where not only what happens is unacceptable, as in Tori's case, and I'm so sorry you've had that experience, that's just appalling, but also the person will be held to blame for it and will be told, this is all your fault, if only you were a better life mother, lover, cook, cleaner, then all of this wouldn't go on. So there's a range of very complicated psychological and emotional abusive factors that go into silencing women. And of course the big one is out there in society. Our first thing is, oh well, why doesn't she just leave, or why doesn't she fight back, or constant questioning of women about what they do or don't do or what they should or shouldn't do, rather than actually saying, hang on, his behaviour is unacceptable. Why doesn't he cut it out? Why doesn't he leave? Why doesn't he go and get help and allow her and her children to live their life in peace and security and safety, which is exactly what everyone has a right to do.
And of course, so many women are not in a position to leave because they've experienced financial abuse as well. They don't have the resources to be able to leave. You obviously could, Tori, but the torment continued, and you kept it to yourself, which must have made it even harder. Why?
Well, number one, I had a very public profile and I was representing, and I still do represent, the best global brands in the world. And so for me, I had to really segment and compartmentalise my life. So while I was launching these incredible brands and making record decisions with retailers, on the other hand, I couldn't tell them what I was going through out of fear that they wouldn't hire me. You know, was my skill set good enough? Could I perform? Because I had this stress going on in my personal life. So
you feared people would think you were too vulnerable?
Absolutely. Mm. Absolutely. So no one knew this was going on. So I could count on, you know, four or five fingers exactly, you know, who the friends were that I could confide in. But I was very careful because I didn't confide everything in everyone, because I didn't want everyone to join the dots and have a story come out in the media about what I was going through.
We should never lose sight, Karen, of the different forms that abuse can take. We tend to think of physical abuse and we can see the bruises and we can see the scars, but emotional abuse and verbal abuse can be just as detrimental.
Absolutely. And in fact, less than 20% of the domestic violence that goes on is the physical stuff. And while that is absolutely appalling, what women will often say to us is, oh, look, give me a black eye any day, the bruise is gone in a fortnight. It's the words that hurt, it's the fear that stays, it's that constant moving sands of not knowing what's going to happen next. It's living your life walking on eggshells and never knowing when the next abuse, when the next attack, when the next pain or hurt is going to occur. That's what actually does the damage. And in fact, that's what our counsellors spend most of their time working with. Mm. The insidious nature over a long period of time of this sort of violence, particularly by someone who says, I love you, is I don't think we can underestimate the impacts.
Yeah, you're nodding there in agreement, Tori. You're living proof, of course, that you can get through this.
Yeah.
And I think, am I right in thinking you really obviously felt you owed it to your daughter to get out of that toxic environment?
Absolutely. Mm. And it was a decision that we made together, and one that we really had to work together as a family unit to come up with the right solution. And the way I looked at it with her was, you know, what kind of family life do you want? Where do you want to be in the next 10, 20 years? When you get married, what does this look like for you? And we really identified what it was, and we sat down and we mapped out a plan and we manifested it, and thank God it happened.
And powerful steps, your new business launching today. Just tell us quickly what that's about.
So I've decided that my story is going to resonate with a lot of women that are going through this. Obviously, one in four do. And we're launching a series of workshops to basically inspire, encourage and empower women to take those powerful steps to come out the other side.
And Karen, help is all available, is always available, isn't it?
Absolutely. It doesn't matter what state or territory you're in. There's 1-800-RESPECT, and then there's services at state and local levels. Women's health centres are a great place to talk to as well.
We greatly appreciate you both speaking with us today. No one should suffer in silence, Tori, and congratulations. As I say, it takes courage to speak out, and power to you.
Thank you.